Welcome to Research Roundtable. My name is Annette Brown, Principal Economist here at FHI 360, and I'm speaking today with my colleague, Dr. Betsy Tolley. Welcome, Betsy.
Hi. Thank you.
We're going to be talking about her article recently published in AIDS and Behavior titled Acceptability of Long-Acting Injectable Cabotegravir in HIV Uninfected Individuals, HPTN 077. So, Betsy, there's a bit of a setup here to understand the context for your study that's very important. I want to start by talking about this drug, cabotegravir. I hope I'm saying that right. Can you tell us what this drug is and why it's so interesting?
Sure. Okay, so long-acting cabotegravir, or CABLA for short, is a novel anti-HIV agent that is currently being tested as a pre-exposure prophylaxis. So pre-exposure prophylaxis, or PrEP, which is much easier, are products that can be used, it's easier to say, are products that can be used by someone who is not infected with HIV to prevent getting infected. And you may have heard of a product called Truvada. So it is a daily oral pill that is already available in many places and has been shown to be highly effective in preventing HIV as long as it's taken correctly and consistently. But that issue, this sort of adherence issue, has been a real challenge, especially for women, for a couple of reasons. One is that women, more than men, have to maintain a really high level of adherence for it to be effective. And we have found in past trials that women especially find challenges adhering to PrEP. So CABLA, in that sense, which is being delivered as an injection, is really promising because it provides yet another modality in the arsenal and hopefully one that will overcome some of the adherence challenges that people are finding.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Okay, so your study is part of the HPTN 077 trial. For those who don't know, HPTN is the HIV Prevention Trials Network, and it's a framework under which a lot of HIV prevention studies are conducted. And 077 is part of a short series of these trials. So tell us just a little bit about 077 and the series of trials.
Sure. So 077 is a phase two trial. And phase two trials tend to be relatively small. They recruit lower risk individuals, and they're aimed at assessing safety, tolerability, and actually pharmacodynamics and kinetics, the way that the drug works within the body. If a product is shown successful in a phase two trial, it will advance to a phase three trial. And in fact, at the moment, there are two different phase three trials for CABLA, one in women, one in men. The HPTN 083 study has been stopped because they found that CABLA is as effective as Truvada in preventing HIV in men, in MSM, in transgender women. So that's a great development. We'll still see where the women's trial goes, but we're excited about that news.
Yeah, that's great news. And that makes the findings of your analysis all the more relevant. So for your acceptability study, first tell us a little bit about what questions you started with.
Right. So in terms of acceptability, there were three different things we were looking at. One was, how acceptable are the various aspects, the attributes of the product, things like the timing, the dosing, the quantity of the injection, as well as how acceptable is the level of pain that people experience. A second thing is how much would these participants prefer a long-acting injectable to, say, an oral pill or vaginal rectal gel, so other PrEP modalities. And then the third thing we were looking at was, outside of this clinical trial, how likely would people be to want to use a product, an injectable product, if it were, you know, if it were deemed effective? So those are the three things.
Right, which for men it has been now. Great. So what are the headline findings?
All right. So headline findings were that, first of all, attributes are highly acceptable across the board in the study. I would say except for pain, which again was acceptable, but more somewhat acceptable for most people. In terms of preferences, men and women, regardless of sort of US and non-US setting, preferred an injectable PrEP over other modalities. And the interesting thing about that was baseline preferences were already relatively high, but after people had had experience getting injections, at least three or more, that preference for an injectable PrEP increased, even to more than 90% in non-US settings. And the final thing is that in terms of interest in using an injectable PrEP outside of a trial, interest was much higher in African than US settings. For women, it was higher if they'd had experience using an injectable contraceptive method. And pain itself was not so predictive of interest in using a PrEP product outside of the trial. So those are kind of three interesting things that we learned from the study.
That's really interesting. You were able to collect so much detailed information about these attributes and how they are affecting people's intention to use. And you did this using a questionnaire that you've used before.
That's right. We originally developed a set of questions in a sister study that was conducted on a different product. And then we're able to use the same questionnaires, the same sets of questions in this 077 study.
That's great. And I always love it when we can collect data in the same way across studies so that we can make more comparisons. So I hope you get to use it again.
Me too.
So I want to talk a little bit about what the takeaways are from your study that we can use in practice already. But you know, I know that there are some people who feel like the acceptability information that we get out of a phase two trial really shouldn't be applied in practice because of the nature of the trial. So what do you say to those folks? And then what should the takeaways from your research be?
Look, it's true that in any kind of trial, there are some participants who don't join the trial with an intention to really use the product or an interest in using the product outside of the trial. But there's still so much we can learn in any of these trials that we should, and we should take advantage of that. Things like, how do people experience actually receiving the product? What are some of the problems around adherence? And who are the people, if not themselves, you know, what kinds of people would most be interested in using this product once it's proven effective? So, and I guess, maybe just as a bottom, you know, kind of final takeaways for this particular study, I would say a couple of things. We know now that, first of all, that women who have used an injectable contraceptive are more likely to find this product acceptable, and especially in African settings where women are at high risk and don't have the sort of track record around a daily oral PrEP. This is really promising, and I would say let's already begin to look at ways that you might be able to co-locate or co-provide injectable contraception, injectable PrEP in one location. So maybe just one takeaway. There are lots of other ones.
No, I think that's a really good takeaway. And I also really felt that, you know, that you would think that the low-risk population would be less tolerant of pain, and yet pain wasn't really a constraint here. So, you know, the bias kind of works the other way. And so I think that those results must still be really relevant to understanding how we can begin to think about putting CABLA into practice.
No, that's a great point. Yeah, I think that's also one.
Great. Well, Betsy, I really want to thank you for joining us here and for sharing the results of your study. I recommend everybody to read the article in AIDS and Behavior. I also like to encourage our viewers to check out other episodes of Research Roundtable. So thank you, Betsy, and thank you to our viewers.
Thanks a lot, Annette. This is fun.